Simon & Schuster Audio presents Five Presidents, My Extraordinary Journey with Eisenhower, Kennedy, Johnson, Nixon, and Ford by Clint Hill with Lisa McCubbin. Read by George Newbern.
This book is dedicated to the men and women of the United States Secret Service, past and present, who have worked tirelessly to keep the occupant of the office of the President of the United States in a secure environment, through good times and bad, without regard to political party affiliation of the protectee. You served long, tedious hours under stress and in the face of danger, without complaint, to ensure continuity of our government as directed by the Constitution and its amendments. No matter the challenges or obstacles, you remained true to the Secret Service code of honor, worthy of trust and confidence. I am proud to have served in your ranks. Introduction. Walking beside history. As a special agent in the United States Secret Service, I had the honor and privilege of serving five presidents: Dwight D. Eisenhower, John F. Kennedy, Lyndon B. Johnson, Richard M. Nixon, and Gerald R. Ford. Three Republicans and two Democrats. From my unique vantage point, I had the rare opportunity to observe the human side of these men, the most powerful men in the world, as each dealt with the enormous responsibilities and unforeseen challenges thrust upon them, and how their individual characters and personalities affected grave decisions. My 17 years in the Secret Service spanned the period that encompassed the U-2 spy incident, the Cold War, the Cuban Missile Crisis, the assassinations of President John F. Kennedy, Martin Luther King Jr., and Robert F. Kennedy, the Civil Rights Movement, riots and burning of major U.S. cities, the Vietnam War, Watergate, and the resignations of Vice President Spiro T. Agnew and President Nixon. In less than two decades, America went from being unquestionably the most respected and admired nation in the world to a country whose image had become tarnished by violence, scandal, and deceit. It is interesting to note that of these five presidents, only Eisenhower had a normal run as president, elected by the people and serving two full terms. Kennedy was elected in 1960 by the slimmest of margins, and his term lasted just 1,000 days, cut short by an assassin. Suddenly, the vice president became president. Johnson was reelected the following year, but when the demands of the office and the casualties of the Vietnam War became more than he could bear, he chose not to run for a second term. Nixon was elected in 1968, and again in 1972. But in the wake of the Watergate scandal, he became the first United States president to resign in 1974. A year earlier, when Nixon's vice president, Spiro Agnew, resigned in disgrace, Nixon appointed Gerald Ford as vice president. Thus, upon Nixon's resignation, Ford became president, never having been elected to the office. It was a turbulent time, and there I was, in the middle of it all. As with our two previous books, my talented writing partner, Lisa McCubbin, and I have attempted to bring history to life through my experiences. While Mrs. Kennedy and me focused on my interactions with Jacqueline Kennedy, and 5 days in November detailed those tragic days surrounding the assassination, the Kennedy section in this book focuses on my observations of and interactions with President Kennedy. There is unavoidably some overlap, but the recollections of my years with Eisenhower, Johnson, Nixon, and Ford are revealed here for the first time. There's no doubt that the assassination of President Kennedy was a defining moment for me, and it would affect me on many levels for the rest of my life. I was thrust onto the pages of history, but it has often bothered me that I would be remembered solely for my actions on that one day. For there was much that led up to that moment, and much that followed. Like the five presidents I served, there were many things that influenced the decisions I made, the actions I took, the man I became. It has indeed been an extraordinary journey. Part 1. With President Eisenhower. When I was sworn into the U.S. Secret Service as a special agent in 1958, President Dwight D. Eisenhower was well into the second year of his second term. As the supreme commander of the Allied forces in World War II, he was credited with liberating Europe, which made him a worldwide hero. General Eisenhower had entered politics as a moderate Republican and had earned the respect of the nation, with 85% of the country viewing him favorably. The American people trusted his judgment and leadership during a time when the threat of a nuclear attack by the Soviet Union was a very real fear for all of us. The Eisenhower era was one of peace and prosperity. Just 7 months into his term, Eisenhower had ended the Korean War, and his conservative fiscal policies led to unprecedented expansion. Having seen the numerous benefits of the Autobahns in Germany, Eisenhower initiated America's interstate highway system, which created an abundance of jobs as roads and bridges were constructed across the country. People were proud to be Americans, proud of our country, and proud of our president. Chapter 1. The Secret Dead Body. All I could think of as I stared at the dead woman lying on the bed was, how the hell are we going to get her body out of here without anyone knowing? There were only a few hours of darkness left, so some quick decisions had to be made. It was my first month as a special agent in the United States Secret Service, and I knew if I screwed this up, my career would be over before it really began. Fortunately, I had the home telephone number of my supervisor, Earl Scholl, the special agent in charge, SAIC of the Denver field office, in my wallet. I walked quietly downstairs and dialed his number from the phone in the kitchen. "Hello," Scholl answered groggily. "Mr. Scholl," I said, "it's Clint Hill. I'm sorry to call you in the middle of the night, but we have a situation here at the Dowd residence." Few people knew it, but President Dwight D. Eisenhower had ordered part-time Secret Service protection for his 80-year-old mother-in-law, Mrs. Elvira Dowd. There were no outright threats to the president's mother-in-law, but because she was ill and lived alone, except for a maid and a nurse, there was concern that she could be kidnapped and held for bargaining purposes. Likewise, if there was a major health problem during the night, the agents would have the means to quickly get her the help she needed, and also be able to immediately notify the president and Mrs. Eisenhower. On September 22, 1958, I was given a badge, handcuffs, holster, gun, and ammunition, and officially sworn in as a special agent in the United States Secret Service. I was taken out to the shooting range at the U.S. Mint in Denver to make sure I could qualify, and that was it. There was no other immediate training except for reading the special agent manual. One of my first assignments was on the midnight shift, protecting Mrs. Dowd. Mrs. Dowd lived in a three-story brick home at 750 Lafayette Street in Denver, Colorado, and the protection was from 7 o'clock in the evening until 7 o'clock in the morning, with one agent on duty from 7 p.m. until 11 p.m., and another agent taking over from 11 p.m. until 7 a.m. First Lady Mamie Eisenhower and her sister Mabel, whom everyone called Mike, had been visiting their mother over the past week and were so grateful for the agents to stay the night with her that they prepared sandwiches for us each evening and left them in the fridge. It was a very nice gesture, and they weren't so bad when Mamie made them, but when Mike got involved, let me tell you, those were the worst sandwiches I ever tasted. I never could figure out exactly what she put between the slices of white bread that tasted so bad, but it was almost inedible. The Mike and Mamie sandwiches were a running joke among the agents in the Denver office. That particular night, I had come to work just before 11, and the departing agent told me there had been no unusual activity. The house was quiet, with Mrs. Dowd and her nurse asleep upstairs on the second floor, and the maid Mary in her room on the third floor. I had been at the house for a couple of hours when I heard Mrs. Dowd calling for her nurse. The nurse stayed in the bedroom adjacent to Mrs. Dowd, and I assumed she would attend to her needs. A few minutes later, however, Mrs. Dowd called out again, this time a bit louder. I waited a few more minutes, listening closely for any conversation upstairs, but there was just silence. When Mrs. Dowd called out a third time, I realized that the nurse must be asleep. I walked up the stairs and into Mrs. Dowd's room. "Mrs. Dowd, I'm Agent Hill. Is there a problem?" She coughed and then said, "I've been calling for the nurse." "She's probably asleep, ma'am," I said. "I'll go tell her you need her." I walked into the nurse's room, and in the darkness, I saw the outline of her body on the bed. I called out to her in a firm voice, but she didn't budge. An uneasy feeling started to come over me as I walked toward the bed. I placed my hand on her shoulder and started to shake her. but her body was stiff as a board. Oh, God, I thought. The nurse is dead. From the other room, Mrs. Dowd called out, Agent, where's my nurse? I did not want to tell her that her nurse was dead. Just a minute, I said as I ran up the stairs to the maid's room on the third floor. Mary, wake up, I whispered as I shook her. It's Agent Hill, Mary. You need to wake up. The nurse is dead and Mrs. Dowd needs some help. You need to get up and help Mrs. Dowd. Mary sat straight up in bed, her eyes like big white marbles against the dark black of her skin, opened so wide that I thought they were going to pop right out of her head. Oh, my lordy, she exclaimed. Shh, Mary, I said. I don't want to alarm Mrs. Dowd. Please go down and see what she needs, and don't tell her the nurse is dead. As soon as Mary went into Mrs. Dowd's room, I went back into the nurse's room to try to figure out what to do. The problem was that Mrs. Eisenhower had just left Denver that morning, headed back to Washington by train. She was afraid of flying, so she always took the train.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.